Ciao! I am Renato Floris, the publisher of all the entertaining and scholarly books on Rudy Valentino and Natacha Rambova by Evelyn Zumaya. I'm here today with Evelyn to discuss more about her fascinating work. Ciao, Evelyn!
Ciao, Renato! I want to direct our discussion in this episode in several directions, but all of them are connected through and inspired by the grand subject of Natacha Rambova's bad rap. The other day, someone posted on our Facebook page that they were sick of hearing about her, how Valentino, and I quote, wised up and saved his career from her ravaging. Wow. So this is where I begin this discussion. First of all, the obvious initial response is, how long can you even discuss Valentino without talking about the queen at his side for 4 years, Natacha Rambova? Bearing in mind that it was not until the fall of 1921, when Valentino became famous enough to merit a household name, and he and Natacha divorced in 1926, separating in August of 1925. He would die 1 year later, so during basically his entire brief Hollywood career, Natacha was there through it all, except for the last year. And I contend she was still very much a part of his psyche during that last year, and especially his last days, but more on that soon. Now, Natasha's importance in Valentino's life was paramount. It was not as if she was some fling, a casual girlfriend who came and went. I contend that any discussion on Valentino must include Natacha Rambova, and I think he would want it that way. After they separated, he had only good things to say about her publicly, despite that very difficult year.
If they were together all those years, they must have been happy together.
They were, and there are so many anecdotes about their happiness that it's sad to me these are so often ignored in favor of those diatribes by the Natacha haters, who seem to be unable to cease in their unfounded hate towards this great woman. Valentino and Rambova had so much in common, and were two young people who had fun with life, horseback riding, and I add well-dressed as cowboys in Palm Springs, dancing on the mineral lava tour, carrying on smuggling their Canadian whiskey on board the train, all the traveling they did and with their many animals, and I think all the photos and images of them in their homes is more than sufficient proof they were sure enjoying their marriage, despite the differences that drove them to separate, whether it was business, her not wanting children then, or the pressures of their fame. The time they spent together was obviously genuine. I think people, the Natacha haters, do not give enough attention to a few basic facts that, one, they were so very young, both of them. They were in their 20s, and I will say that few people have their lives all tied up in a big bow in their 20s. They also were facing overwhelming dynamics, the public attention, the fame machine, the demands on Valentino, and the complexities of his business and personal life. Until George Ullman arrived in 1923, Natacha took care of most logistical things, and as Ullman wrote in his 1975 memoir, he felt that Rudy, and I quote, just got mentally lazy in Natasha's presence. He deferred to her, and she was capable. Capable as an art director, as a personal manager, and for a few years as a wife. I will not digress here to address those inanities that they were a platonic couple, and theirs was an arranged marriage. This is a new invention. I will say a delusion, as proposed by Mank, Steiger, and Brett, invented to bolster their crass sensationalizing of Valentino's sexual identity by having him fear his wife, Natacha. Where is proof of that? This stands as completely self-serving fiction and false. And how demeaning of Valentino to portray him as being so weak.
Why do you think people hated Natacha so much and say she almost destroyed Valentino's career?
I think Natacha was not that hated openly during the 1920s, and she was in fact a fashion icon. until the divorce, people in general were reading fan magazine articles about the Valentino's home life and such, but some people blamed her for wanting to elevate Valentino's movies and have him act in higher quality roles. This was very true, and it did not set well with the fans who wanted more chicing. And, of course, the greedy Hollywood moguls wanted her out, because she cost them money, with her rewrites of scripts and demands for expensive sets and costumes. But the deep hatred and vilification of Natacha began in the 1960s, I think. She was always portrayed as being tough and strong, probably too much so for her day. But Valentino and Rambova were then portrayed as husband and wife and loving each other, until the Rudy is Victim campaign began in the 1960s, and that continues until today. I contend that the haters in the Valentino world today, those who hate Natacha, hate Allman, hate me, hate you, Renato, they invented that for the sake of scandal, for sensationalism, and to those people who traipse along after them unquestioning, they need to look at some history and reject these idiotic fictions.
I know Michael Morris felt Natacha invented Valentino's image.
He did. And I'm going to read a short excerpt from his posthumous and authorized book, Beyond Valentino, the Madame Valentino Addendum, which you published and I co-authored after his tragic death. From page 45, and I quote, "Of all her lovers, Natacha Rambova exercised her greatest influence on silent film icon Rudolph Valentino. She would transform him from the mustachioed villain of his earliest films prior to their meeting in 1920 into the pomaded leading man he became. Natacha's influence over Valentino catapulted him into the paragon of style and costumed elegance, thereby defining his legacy and ensuring his role as a Hollywood icon." End quote. You know, Renato, George Ullman wrote that he felt Natacha elevated Valentino in many ways and that he owed a great deal to her. I think this is one reason Valentino adored her. She grew up going between her private school outside of London, Leatherhead Court, and her Aunt Elsie de Wolfe's Via Trianon outside of Paris. And no matter what people say about Natacha, they cannot deny she was cultured. This is what she shared with Valentino and what she brought to his life and legacy. And I found this quote about her so well spoken in this regard. It is something that journalist Herb Howe wrote in 1930, and I quote, "Even her worst enemy has admitted the genius of Natacha, that unquenchable flame of ambition that sweeps out from her ruthlessly. It is an implacable instinct, a fighting spirit of Amazonian fierceness. Yet for all her eclectic vitality, I think Natasha's spirit is a little weary. Very young, she has witnessed with shrewd eyes the mockery of the world's spectacle, and from the highest throne of idolatry this age has known, she has experienced its sharp irony." End quote. Now, Natasha's knowledge of art, both historical and modern references, was remarkable. And this was shared with Valentino and became apparent in his life in many ways. His clothing, his style, his demeanor, and even his antique collections. But after 2 decades researching this couple, I in no way ever found a snippet saying she was in control. He always was, even when deferring to her. And this brings us back to the Rudy is victim concept, purported today by the haters of all things Ullman, Rambova, and us, who are led by their fearless leaders, whether they slather it outright online or in their Facebook groups, or support it with their very loud silence. They lead the pack of haters in the Valentino world today, and I, for one, find that tragic. They seem to ignore the genesis of those hateful attitudes and do not question. Do they actually believe that Valentino shook in fear at Natasha's presence? How ridiculous. Yet she is called every name in the book, and by Brett. His go-to Natacha bashing is always to call her, quote, the harpy lesbian. Well, that is extremely homophobic, and the entire ugly name-calling by Brett when he consistently demeans lesbians with antiquated stereotypes should no longer be supported, in my opinion. When will that no longer be tolerated? and despite my presenting evidence that it was Valentino who demanded the separation and cut Natacha out of his business, a few weeks ago, Renato, I read where Tracy Terhune was discussing this as if it was new information, because some letters of Natasha's were brought up for auction. Well, maybe he should sit down and finally read Affairs Valentino, because I presented that 10 years ago in the very book he is working hysterically to ruin. So Natacha is generally blamed for the divorce, for controlling her husband, and in this, I have to read one more quote from an interview she gave in 1930 with journalist Herb Howe. This is Natacha speaking, and I quote, "Rudy had pride, a legitimate man's pride, and they worked on that. They commenced bringing him clippings which said, 'Mrs. Valentino wears the pants. Too bad Rudy can't be his own boss,' and so forth and so forth. These rankled. Eventually, if I so much as observed it was a nice day, Rudy, about to agree, would catch himself and say, 'No, it's not.' Of course I realized how he felt. He didn't want to be putty, even in his wife's hands. We would laugh about the clippings. Nevertheless, they made a wedge." And some of this wedge came from those homophobic innuendos made by homophobic detractors trying to defuse Valentino's popularity.
The play she wrote, All That Glitters, reveals so much about their actual marriage, I think.
Yes, it does, Renato. And this brings me today to a turn in the same direction of Natasha's role in Valentino's life and why she is so hated. Yes, in 1927, she wrote a screenplay she titled All That Glitters. The play has never been produced and was not made public until recently. Natasha's cousin shared a copy of it with her biographer, Michael Morris, and there is a copy housed in the Library of Congress. It has now been published by 1921 BBC Publishing and is also included in the Beyond Valentino addendum if readers want to read it. Because Natacha never published it, nor pursued producing it on stage, it was a private document, all in all. I think she perhaps intended it to be this way, but in All That Glitters, Natacha seemed to find her voice in vanquishing her Hollywood life and all the misunderstandings and lies purported about her in the Valentino marriage. As you remember, when Michael Morris and I first began working on his Madame Valentino addendum in 2013 or so, he loved to discuss the play, and especially who the various characters she created represented. I will add as a side note here that he always wanted to include a discussion between the two of us about this, which I did. I initially told him this was a bad idea because the team would come after me again, but he insisted, saying we could not let, and I quote, not let the devil's brigade run our lives. And I'm going to refer to his comment on the play in Beyond Valentino, which I will read from page 110, and I quote, "Natacha occupied her time writing a serial comic play, a three-act, thinly-veiled indictment of Hollywood and her marriage to Rudolph Valentino. Titled All That Glitters, the work opened old wounds with such a merciless surgical precision that Muzzy wept when she read it. All That Glitters was never produced on stage. It may have been too risky a venture, in that so many of its characters were uncomplimentary depictions of powerful celebrities. Nevertheless, writing it was therapeutic for Natacha, who portrayed her marriage to Rudy as vindicated and saved, if only in the make-believe realm, her own play attacked." So the characters in our discussion, which begin in the book on page 251, I think it's worth reading. But in going through the cast of characters of the play, first things first, Renato Floris, we both always found it an odd serendipity that two of the characters are Floris and Morris. Michael Morris was always amused by that, too. Nomen omen.
Yeah.
In any case, obviously Henry is Valentino and Alice is Natacha, with Kendall being George Ullman, Schwartz being probably Joe Skank. Floris McGillicuddy, June Mathis, Mary Elizabeth Binter and her mother would be Mary Pickford and her mother, and Buckle the Butler as Lou Mahoney, just to name a few. I think the most interesting revelation in the character she created is the dynamic between Alice and Kendall as Natacha and George Ullman. Now, I think this play is fiction, obviously, and do not believe Ullman was romantically drawn to Natacha, but she did not write him as a villain, and the two of them were portrayed as the long-suffering managers of the main attraction of the household, a rather oblivious Rudolph Valentino. I think Marcel Marsan was probably based on Gloria Swanson, because Natacha makes a reference to a walking stick which she gave Valentino. Some have said this could be Nitta Naldi, but did Valentino have affairs, as Natacha implies in All That Glitters, and always come back to her? Did she really not care, as she has her character portray, just knowing he did not love these other women? Now, the other storyline that is revealing and interesting to me is that of the butler Buckle, who would have been Valentino's handyman, Lou Mahoney. And I'm going to read my comment about that in my exchange with Michael, and a few more comments from our discussion on page 251 in Beyond Valentino. And I say, and I quote, "One of the most interesting aspects of this play is the mention of the dry cleaning business. When I was researching Affairs Valentino, I discovered the history of this company, which actually existed as Ritz Cleaners. In Lou Mahoney's interview with Movie Classics magazine in 1973, he stated that he had never had anything to do with that dry cleaning business which Valentino owned. When I discovered the court records of Valentino's estate settlement, I found Ullman sold the business to Lou Mahoney along with a company truck for $200. He subsequently ran the business for a few years." Michael Morris answers, "In All That Glitters, did Rambova reveal that Mahoney was running the business out of their home before it became Valentino's business? Was the graft she referred to in an article she wrote in 1923 a revelation? What other reason would Natacha have to include this odd element to her storyline?" And I reply, "Rambova's hatred for Hollywood is apparent, as she consistently sets herself above those in Hollywood in the play. She does so by referring to the vulgarity and lack of taste of the people in the play. This is revealed especially through the character of the Count." End quote.
Natacha portrays Valentino as being rather spoiled and reckless with his business, isn't
it? She does. And the insights into the Valentino marriage and household are many in All That Glitters. Such as his comments about, by the way, something we talked about in a previous podcast, which a listener pointed out to me, his appearance in Bernard McFadden's Physical Culture magazine, from page 145. This is where Henry, the character of Valentino, is talking with Schwartz, the character of Joe Skank. Henry says, "Foolishness, do you think it is fun for me to train all morning, to be in condition to take those stills for your publicity department? Mo has landed a big story with Physical Culture and all the other magazines are asking for new stuff." And Schwartz says, "I could buy the whole damn magazine for what that mob has cost me today." End quote. So basically, in the play, Natacha portrays herself as quietly and efficiently managing to save the reckless spender Valentino and keep him on task, while she bore the brunt of the suffering. I think it's important to remember when she wrote this, and remember that she did not publish it. This was a private statement, and one where she and Valentino's character Henry reconcile at the end of the play to leave Hollywood to be happy ever after. It is obvious she had no love for the ego-driven vanity of Hollywood, portraying all the posing and the grasping and the display with open disdain. Michael Morris wrote that he felt Natacha had to write this play, as she felt she was still under attack and she had to prove herself in this. But the insight is there. Her role was not a happy one, and this was especially so after Valentino's death. And this brings me back to the current worst of the hate Natacha situation, which was not only born and nurtured by the homophobic fiction of Steiger, Mank, and Brett, but is still perpetuated nonstop without questioning any historical accuracy at all. Historically, Natacha was targeted for not bearing Valentino's children, for their divorce, and for trying to take his screen career in perhaps a dubious direction, away from the action roles. But this angst toward her really was profoundly amplified over the years, and she was heaved into the haters' trash pile of those who they claim took advantage of Rudolph Valentino, portraying him as the victim. Now, this past week, you, Renato, said something to me that hit me in this regard. I was lamenting the haters' attacks on us, and you said, they hate you because you refuse to make Valentino a victim. So true. And this making Valentino the victim of his wife, Natacha, of his manager, George Allman, and even us now, that ramping up of the history of irrational hate really began in the falsehoods originally purported by Valentino's jealous brother, Alberto, who with little basis in fact gave interviews laden with inaccuracies, which of course went down as being truth because people thought the only brother would know something. Turns out he really did not. But the damage was done, and today Valentino is seen as a victim by the haters, and those falsehoods about Natacha and Allman are now accepted as fact, despite all the documentation I brought forth to clarify. In saying jealous brother, I feel this is in no way a stretch. His actions were openly carried out. His surgeries, his quest to be Rudolph. It is painfully obvious this is so. And I allege, as in it is my opinion, that as much as he did love his brother, his frustrations at not being him left a tragic legacy fraught with hate and hating people. I cite as an example of the false statements made by Alberto Guglielmi Valentino in an article in the Italo Americano, dated October 1, 1977, an interview written by Argentina Brunetti. Alberto is asked several questions, and here he states, and I quote, "On account of the sudden death of Rudolfo, his manager, George Allman, who was the executor of the will and to whom Rudolfo had given power of attorney to manage all his affairs, he immediately profited by the situation and made a pile of investments, loans, etc., which turned sour. Of the money my brother left, we never saw 1 cent. We demanded an accounting of the investments, but all was in vain. We were betrayed by our own lawyers. After years of waiting at the liquidation, there was not 1 penny left for the boy." Later on in the interview, he says, "When did Rudolfo know of your son? When he left Italy, naturally, your son had not been born yet." Alberto answers, "No, of course. I was not even married yet. Rudolfo returned to Italy when Johnny was 9 years old. I was then municipal secretary of the city of Campobasso." And the last reference I make to this quite lengthy article today is his reference to Natacha. And I quote, "It was Natacha who wanted a divorce. She was interfering too much in the production of Rudolfo's films. In principle, she was only in charge of the costumes and scenery, but she began to lay down the rules for everybody and everything and to influence contracts. She wished to be the sole authority on anything having to do with the films of her husband. Rudolfo let her have her way only because he was so madly in love with her. However, the producer, Joe Skank, wanted no part of such an arrangement. He offered Valentino a contract making him co-producer, but with the proviso that Natacha was completely excluded from participation. She would possibly be refused entrance to the studios. These facts made her furious. For my brother, it was a sort of death before he actually died." So, I first dispute Alberto saying he never saw 1 cent from his brother Rudolph's money. How many ways is this statement wrong and then more wrong, if one has even a minimal understanding of the facts? I will not take the time to repeat this all here. I have covered it in Affairs Valentino and in previous episodes. But Allman did not make investments immediately. He was then paying bills and organizing the auction, and he surely did not profit from being Valentino's executor. His loss was lifelong. This statement by Alberto is outrageously false. Alberto sure saw more than 1 cent from his brother's estate. Allman advanced some $70,000 to the three people he believed then to be the heirs, including Alberto. This would be, by today's conversion in spending value, times 13, almost $1 million at $910,000. Paula Negri gave Alberto another $15,000, which would be, by today's conversion, $195,000. And the numbers of Alberto's income are included in the court audit books, and it is astounding he went through that much money in such a short time. I secondly dispute his statement that he was married when Valentino left Italy. It was a year before, in fact, because I found his marriage certificate. And lastly, today, I dispute Alberto saying that Natacha left Valentino, abandoning him, casting her in this role. Valentino sent Natacha packing. It was not the other way around. And she was not mentioned in that contract with Skank, and I will be posting that online soon. She was not banned from the studios until much later on, after a meeting with the Eagle writers, and this was done by personal memo. These things contributed to their separation, but she was in a role of demanding greater respect and quality in Valentino's movies, not out to have her complete control as some conniving motive. The reason for Ullman securing the United Artists contract was a more sinister one, as I have revealed in Affairs Valentino. The betrayal of Ritz-Carlton Pictures. Ullman wrote in detail about this contract, and it is included in the court records, and Alberto stating Natasha's role in this is false. So the falsehoods and blatant innuendos bandied about by Alberto and presented as fact were ultimately not insignificant, and they play a huge role in his family's perpetuating them today. I allege that Alberto portrayed his brother as a victim, placing both Ullman and Natacha in roles as sinister villains, which is not the case at all. And Alberto also portrayed himself as a victim, when according to the audits and court records, it was he who squandered the estate money on his initial spending when he arrived in Los Angeles and on attorneys for years, leaving nothing for, as he called him, the boy. It makes one wonder. If Rudy had not died, would Natacha have still been the villain? Would they have remarried, maybe had 5 children? Maybe he would have married somebody else and lived happily ever after. Obviously, time stopped in Valentino's story when he died, and the haters have seen to it that it does not progress forward 1 minute. Some things have been frozen since then, with little perspective or wisdom granted. With the hate being further incited by those proving their loyalty to the Alberto party line as the legacy of the jealous brother, who portrayed his brother as being so weak and stupid that he surrounded himself with people taking advantage of him. It is my belief that Valentino was not taken advantage by those he loved and trusted, and not a hapless victim. Natacha left his life when she was supposed to go, and I believe their story was not quite over when he died. George Ullman was an honest and loyal friend, and you and I, Renato, are honest, sincere folks too. I ask that people question the hatred. I, for one, do not think it has any place in Rudolph Valentino's legacy, and such things as those that are being spewed on their hate blogs and other social media accounts violate his very memory.
He was a gracious and intelligent young man. Who would be disgusted with these people's behavior? I have no doubt at all.
I agree with you 100%, Renato. And in closing, I can say that there is nothing to hate or reject about the presence of Natacha Rambova in Rudolph Valentino's life. And I, for one, agree with Michael Morris and believe she had so much to contribute to the making of the icon, as he titled his chapter in Beyond Valentino, about her Valentino years. Should we not be grateful to her and appreciative? In Madame Valentino, he included a poem as a tribute to Natacha, written by journalist Ruth Waterbury for a photoplay article which was published in the December 1922 issue. And I quote Madame Valentino, page 123. "She is very subtle, is Natacha Rambova. She is white satin, embroidered in gold. She is absinthe in a crystal glass. She is a copy of Swinburne, bound in scarlet. She is beauty, drugged with sophistication. She is a yellow orchid, shining forth from a vase of black onyx. She is the outward, visible sign of Rudolph Valentino's spiritual evolution. She is the symbol of his culture. She is the crystallization of his success. She is, she says, absolutely natural. She is very subtle, is Natacha Rambova." End quote.
For today, I tell our listeners to subscribe to this podcast so you don't miss any episodes and find all the great books on Amazon. And for today, I say, fiat justitia, ruat celum. And for the nice guys, Arrivederci.